اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد محمد وعلى محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وآل محمد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الذي فطر الخلائق بقدرته ونشر الرياح برحمته وتد بالصخور ميدان أرضه ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد طب القلوب ودوائها ونور أبصارها وعلى أهل بيته الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا على محمد بهم نتولى ومن أعدائهم نتبرى إلى يوم القيامة عباد الله أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم سنريهم آياتنا في الآفاق وفي أنفسهم حتى يتبين لهم أنه الحق أولم يكف بربك أنه على كل شيء شهيد آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم صلوات اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد Once again we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us this opportunity to observe our weekly Eid which is Jumu'ah. I first and foremost admonish myself and each and every one of you, respected brothers and sisters, to have the consciousness of the teachings of Almighty Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, which the Holy Quran refers to as taqwa. Allah azza wa jal expect each and every one of us to try as much as we can to improve the levels of our consciousness or the levels of our taqwa. And those of you who were here last night, we looked at the teachings of Amir al-Mu'mineen on the significance and the importance of taqwa or gaining consciousness. Now in this first sermon, as you know very well, Mu'mineen and Mu'minat, our theme of the month is understanding Nahjul Balagha. And we are still trying as much as we can to extract those understandings and the teachings of Amirul Mu'mineen in the first sermon of Nahjul Balagha. So far, what we've done in the past 2 weeks of Jumu'ah is to look at the both attributes of beauty and attributes of glory. And these are, of course, attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As you know very well, we mentioned several times, to understand the existence of Allah, because I can't say to know Allah. To know Allah is a destination no one will reach. But yes, we can understand the existence of Allah. And through that, we will be equipped with sort of ma'arifah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So from the first line of the first khutbah up until where Imam talks about there is no fixed period and there is no time ordained. That's what we did last week. All those lines are highlighting on Allah's attributes of beauty and Allah's attributes of glory. I want you to kindly pay attention. There is distinction between what is attribute of beauty and attribute of glory. Allah's attributes of beauty are those attributes that affirm something. But attribute of glory negates. So let me give you an example, then we jump into today's sermon. Attribute of beauty to say, Allahu alimun. Allah is learned. Or Allah has knowledge. Or you say, Allahu hayyun. Allah is alive, or Allah is life. You are affirming. That is what theologians refer to as attribute of beauty. But we do have attributes of glory. These are attributes that you negate. You distance Allah from those attributes. Like to say Allah is physical. You have to negate that from Allah. Then you are affirming the attribute of glory. Or to negate that Allah is not confined within a place. That is attribute of glory. Or to say Allah is not faqir. Allah is not poor. Allah is not needy. So you are negating faqr, poverty from Allah. Doing so, it is referred to as attribute of glory. And those of you who are well-versed with the field of theology, these two attributes are often referred to sifat al-thubutiyya and sifat al-salbiyya. Positive attribute, I like to call it that way, and then the negative attributes. So positive, you affirm. Negative, you negate it. You take it away from Allah. What I've just quoted from Najul Balaga, there are only three lines. And I just want to explain these three lines for today's khutbah. Amir al-Mu'mineen is saying, فَطَرَ الْخَلَائِكَ بِقُدَرَتِهِ. You pay attention to this, and inshallah you'll see them on the screen as I explain also. وَنَشَرَ الرِّيَاحَ بِرَحْمَتِهِ. Then he said, وَتَدَّ بِالسُّخُورِ مَيَدَانَ أَرْضِ. Imam Ali said, this is the translation of the khutbah. Said, he brought forth creation through his omnipotence. Omnipotence. And then the second line, Imam says, and he dispersed wind through his compassion. And then the last one, Imam Ali says, and he made firm shaking earth with rocks. These are the three lines that we need to understand today. First and foremost, these three lines are highlighting on attributes of action. Previous lines, attribute of beauty, attribute of glory. These three lines are talking about Allah's attributes of action. Obviously, we mentioned sifatuhu aynu dhateh. وَذَاتُهُ عَيْنُ صِفَاتِهِ. Allah's attributes are Allah's essence. And Allah's essence are Allah's attributes. There is no distinction between His essence and His attributes. Why do we then talk about attributes? It's for my and your understanding. For us to imagine in how Allah administers this universe is through the attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hence, we have all these attributes of Allah. So first one, Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen is saying, Allah brought forth creation. You can think of any creation, of course, in son being the master, through his power or omnipotence. Now, Amir al-Mu'mineen use the term fatara. And I kindly want you to look at this term fatara. Said fatara al-khala'iqa. And in different verses of Quran, Allah use also this terminology fatara. Fatara has different meaning. And understanding the meaning of fatara, then you would then appreciate the power and the omnipotence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in creating us and what you see and benefit from. Because that's the terminology Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen is using. First meaning of fatara is what? Origination. Meaning, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is the originator of creation. Fine, sometimes he said, what is the origin of this sketch? So the origin is Iraq, or the origin is Iran, or the origin is London. Oh, that man. But you see, when we say you are originator and Allah is originator, these are two different things. Huh? You originate on account of experience. You originate on account of consultation. You originate on account of benefiting from the creations of Allah. Allah originated the entire creation without anything being there before that creation. And that is why Bibi Fatima, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayha, in a beautiful sermon of Fadak, there are beautiful line, ibtada al ashiya la min shay'in kana kabla. If Fatima alayhi salam, she said, Allah originated or initiated everything when there was nothing before it. In other words, Allah has no consultants. Allah doesn't need any experience. Allah is experience and is the creator of experience. So Amir al fatara al khala'ika bi qudratih. He originated the entire creation through his power. Telling you that la min shay'in kana kabla. Another meaning of fatara is what? Initiator. Allah initiated everything. If you want to initiate something, you will consult the uncle. You will go and make your research. Today, scientists, all scientists, those who invented, who initiated, you realize that before they did so, they went around for research. Those of us who do PhD, you know how it works. You have to go around for it, but at the end of the day, it is your own property. Although you rely on so many people. That's why when you invent, you have to acknowledge so many people on the preface, on the introduction. But Allah, no. When he say Allah is initiator, he's the entire initiator, and he is the creator of initiation. That's what Amir al-Mu'mineen is saying. No, some scholars said, look, the meaning of fatara, they said the plural is futur. And they said the word iftar is from that word fatara. But they look at different meaning of that, isn't it? They said it's a futur, meaning khalal, flaw, wrongs. They said, no, Amir al-Mu'mineen is trying to say, when you examine the creation of Allah, you will not come across a single flaw or fault. That's why Surah Al-Mulk, الَّذِي خَلَكَ سَبْعَ سَمَاوَاتٍ طِبَاقًا مَا تَرَى فِي خَلْكِ الرَّحْمَنِ مِنْ تَفَاوُتٍ فَارْجِعِ الْبَصَرَ هَلْ تَرَى مِنْ فُطُورٍ. My point is futur, pay attention. Futur fa'tara. Allah talks about the creation of the seventh heaven, isn't it? And then Allah is trying to tell us, you will not see any contradiction between what I've created. Then he said, Farji al-Basar. Why can't Basar inner sight, inside? ponder, reflect, pause. Will you see any fault in what I have created? So therefore, the first one, I'm going to fatar al-khala'ika. Here, I'm going to make quick ishara, indication, to some few verses of Quran that Allah talking about fatara. And inshallah, if mu'mineen have time, in your own leisure time, you can do your own research on these verses to comprehend more the meaning of the word fatara, which Amir al-Mu'mineen used in this ayah. First one, Suratul Fatir. We've got Suratul Fatir, the initiator, the originator, the beginner of everything. Right from the beginning of the chapter, Allah comes forward and tells us, Alhamdulillahi, Fatir al-Samawati wal-Ard. Ja'il al-Malaikata Rusulan. Uli ajnihatin mathna wa thulatha wa ruba. Yazidu fil khalqi ma yasha. Inna Allah ala kulli shay'in. Fatir. Now if you look at the meaning of these verses, Allah definitely is talking about this fatara, which Imam Ali is talking about in this line of the khutbah of Fadl. He said, all praise is due to Allah, the originator of the heavens and the earth. And then he said, the maker of the angels, an originator again. The maker of the apostles flying on wings. Some fly with two wings. Some fly with three wings. Some flies with four wings. That is Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. So when Amir said, فَطَرَ الْخَلَائِكَ بِقُدْرَةِ, angels including, jinn including, animal including, insan is including. This just to impress on us to appreciate Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the other ayah is also a very clear ayah of glorious Quran, where Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in Quran 12, that's Surah Yusuf, verse 101, Yusuf makes it very clear. Rabbi ataitani min al-mulk wa allamtani min ta'wil al-ahadith fatir as-samawati wal-ard anta waliyyi fid-dunya wal-akhirah tawaffani musliman wa alhiqni bis-salihin. Surah Yusuf 101. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala still talking about how Allah is a fatir as-samawati wal-ard. Earth belongs to Allah. Heaven belongs to Allah. If you want to make the best out of it, is to connect with the maker and the originator. Now the next line, Imam Ali talks about Allah's power, omnipotence. That you know very well. The power of Allah is absolute power. I ask everyone here in this mosque, our rich, our poor, our learned, who is the most powerful here? Maybe he's got a lot of money. Maybe he's the powerful person in the community. Maulana standing there talking, quoting, maybe powerful person. But really, as a mu'min, as a believer, if you look at, you know what, I've got the money. I'm calling shots. I decide what to be done. But then if you compare your power with that of Allah, what happens? You are expected to be a humble person. Bikudratihi, with this power. Tell you that Allah's power is absolute power. And every power depends on the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because his power is unlimited. And then the next line. وَنَشَرَ الْرِيَاحَ بِرَحْمَتِهِ. Said Allah disperse. Look at it. Nashr. Nashara. Dispersed. What? Wind. Air. Birahmati. Through his compassion. Really, if you want to reflect on this, you look at Surah Al-A'raf. Surah Al-A'raf. Verse 57. Allah talks about this again. الذي يرسل الرياح بشرا بين يدي رحمتي.
He's the one who dispersed these winds as a means of a benefit from his mercy. Now, if you truly want to appreciate that, before you start complaining for whatever challenge you are going into your life, ask yourself, what is the role of wind and air in our lives? Who make wind? Scientists? Molana? Who make wind? Allah! Nashara riyaha amir al-mu'minin is drawing our attention. Pause a little bit and you will stop complaining unnecessarily. Pause a little bit and you will acknowledge that indeed Allah is Allah. Because the air that we breathe in, oxygen, hydrogen, whatever, these are all from Allah. They play a crucial role. One, in the plant kingdom or flower kingdom, without air, there will be no survival. Rain depend on air. Without it, there will be problem. Look, you've got all the AC and the fan here, isn't it? So can you imagine if Allah's air is not out there, what will happen? Nashara riyaha bi rahmati. He is the one. So remember, don't stay away from Allah. Excuse my word. Don't become big-headed, thick-headed. Humble yourself. Calm down. Take it easy. He's there doing it. It's not you. If you are elevated, it's not because you are the smartest. Take it easy. The owner is up there. He's the absolute owner. Assuming you've got everything in this world, can you produce air out there? You can produce artificial one. And there are those with sinus, the artificial one doesn't help them. Hence, Imam said, Nashara riyaha bi rahmati. Yes, we've got cleaners outside who are cleaning. Without natural air, pollution would have killed everyone. The world is talking about global warming, isn't it? Environment. When did Islam, long time, many years ago, this line, Nashara riyaha bi rahmati, is also highlighting on the importance of conserving environment. Because it's the rahmah of Allah. Will you abuse the rahmah of Allah? Air is rahmah. Environment is rahmah. Without air, there will be no environment. Are you going to abuse the rahmah of Allah? So Amir al-Mu'minin is telling us, Nashara riyaha bi rahmati. And then the last one, which is so beautiful. And he said he made firm shaking earth. Shaking, those who know Arabic very well, Mayadan. The earth. Allah made it firm. Through what? Rocks. Do you know really the benefit of rocks and mountains in our lives? Have you ever thought of it? Some, when they get fresher, they go to Snowdon. Snowdon, what is the name of Snowdon? I struggle to pronounce that place, man. Snowdonia. Although I was supposed to go, but later on, they went to mountains. People are climbing mountains, isn't it? Name of Allah. People go to Mountain Kilimanjaro. Country, place without mountain is half. It's a source of income. Not only that, it's a source of health. It's a source of sustenance. In terms of your health. So Allah Tabarakallah said, you know, this earth that you see, you know, scientists discover when? That the earth is in constant motion. Yeah? Changing. It's in movement. And that's why we have a proof of movement to prove the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah used the rocks to keep it firm. Al-jibala awtada. Allah is mentioning it in Quran. These are just not there. And the last ayah, you know, Quran again. Wa alka fiha rawasiya. Antamida bikum. Allah talks about these mountains, how they are very important. In Quran 16 verse 15, you know what Allah is saying? And he has cast great mountains in the earth, lest it might be convulsed with you, and rivers arose that you may go aright. Allah, let me just conclude this khutbah. Next week we'll continue from here. That if indeed insan think and reflect, he will realize how blessed he or she is. You know, if you happen to visit prisoners, offenders, some are there not because they want to be there. Some are there because they want to be there. Some places you find they've got a small window, a very small, tiny window top there on the corner, and the small air is just coming. Freedom. Freedom is not only about talking. To breathe this air the way you want is freedom. Allah has given us. Why do you complain? Appreciate Allah. There are those, they've got billions, but the air, when it comes, the nose cannot contain it. You go hospital, that's why Islam encouraged us to visit, isn't it? There are people, the air is not enough. They need extra oxygen. Appreciate Allah. Appreciate Allah. You'll only start crying if you do not appreciate. So in conclusion, let's preserve environment. Let's take care of our environment. Our eating habit need to be looked after. The way we throw littering in Islam is haram. It's all about air, because you're polluting the air. Air is the rahmah of Allah. One riwayah of the Prophet said, وَتُمِيتُ لَأَذَىٰ عَنِ الطَّرِيكِ صَدَقَ. You going around about your life and you see garbage, rubbish somewhere, and you pick it up, you take it where it's supposed to be disposed of, it is regarded as charity for you and will be rewarded by Allah on the day of Qiyamah. Let alone people eat here, they throw anyhow. You come to Muslim community, people eat and throw away. This is against Sharia. This is haram. We need to conserve this environment which is given to us by Allah to go about becoming perfect human being. Nashara al-riyah bi rahmati. Hence Rasulullah mentioned, if you plant one tree, one tree, you plant, why? It's not for the sake of the tree itself. It's for the sake of the environment. That one tree is a means of maghfirah for you on the day of Qiyamah. So therefore, let's take heed to these lessons. These lessons are rich from Imam Amir al-Mu'minin. We've got our civil responsibilities to do, Mu'minin and Mu'minat. And as a Muslim, you don't need to be told. You need to understand, you've got civil responsibility to keep your surrounding and environment tidy. A Muslim, excuse my word, should not be remembered when you go to for nature call to ensure that after taking care of your affairs, to ensure the place remains clean. Whether your house, whether your mosque, whether public place, these are the things about environment. Because when you flush the water, where does it go? It's a waste. It's going somewhere. You leave it there, the air is going to be polluted. Whoever is going to enter there, the air is polluted. It means you are not taking care of the amana of Allah. And will be questioned. You're not going to be questioned only about salah. Yes, salah is number one, but it's not going to be only about salah. You're not going to be questioned only about how many times you've been to the mosque. You're going to be questioning about this world that I've given you as amana. How did you manage the world? So therefore, we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to inspire us with the true teachings of Imam Amir al-Mu'minin. Ya Allah, we ask you, forgive us our shortcomings, sir. We ask you, subhanahu wa ta'ala, our brothers and sisters who are not well, and they requested special dua from us. Especially we have an infant who has been in ICU for some time now and is still there after the mother delivered him. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to intervene on behalf of the infant.
As Allah Azza wa Jal, all mu'mineen and mu'minat who are not well, we have our uncle at Queen Elizabeth who is not feeling well. May Allah Azza wa Jal make it easy for him, inshallah.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar. Fasalli li rabbika wanhar. Inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين إنه خير ناصر ومعين ثم صلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد اللهم صل على محمد وسلم اللهم صل وسلم على علينا أمير المؤمنين اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد وعلى الصديقة الطاهرة فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد وعلى سبتي الرحمة وإمامي الهدى الحسن والحسين سيدي شباب أهل الجنة اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد وعلى علي بن الحسين زين العابدين اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والحجة بن الحسن القائم المنتظر عجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف وسهل الله مخرجا اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد اللهم إنا نرغب إليك في دولة كريمة تعز بها الإسلام وأهلا وتذل بها النفاق وأهلا وتجعلنا فيها من الدعاة إلى طاعتك والكادة إلى سبيلك وترزقنا بها كرامة الدنيا والآخرة اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج اللهم اجعلنا من خير أعوانه وأنصاره ومن المستشهدين بين يديه برحمتك يا عزيز يا غفار يا رب العالمين سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.